Joining us is Sam Seder. He's the host of The Majority Report with Sam Seder, Monday through Friday. Everybody should subscribe to The Majority Report. Thank you for doing this. A lot to talk about. The Mueller hearings, or as I call them, the Mueller heart of hearings. Get
well
it?
Well done. Yes, now I get it.
You get it?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. We could talk about that, but I was also, before we started, recommending Ralph Nader to you. And I was surprised by your reaction.
Yeah, I mean, I'm a, you know, a fan of his work for years. I voted for him in 2000. Now I was in New York and I vote swapped. I felt a little bit upset about, you know, I thought he and I had an understanding that he would not campaign in contested races, but that was that. And then I feel like, I mean, I've seen him on other interviews as of late, and I feel like some of the commentary is a little bit less thoughtful than it has been in the past. You know, like in the run-up to the 2018 election, he was claiming that Democrats were running on nothing but Trump is bad. And the fact is that that was unequivocally not true. Most of them were running on healthcare. The irony is, of course, that as much as they were all running from on healthcare, the reason why people voted for them is because Trump is bad.
Okay, I'm not going to argue Ralph Nader with you, the man who gave us seatbelts, OSHA, clean drinking water, the EPA.
Yes.
The greatest living American. One of the greatest living Americans of the 20th century.
There's no doubt in my mind everything you're saying is true. And the worst thing that sometimes you can happen to you is to meet your idols. So,
okay.
I know how difficult this must be for you. Just with me.
All right.
See what happens?
Yeah. Yeah.
We never had this conversation. You wouldn't be so disillusioned about my reticence to interview Ralph Nader. But maybe I'll have him on.
Now, a lot of people think the most underreported catastrophe of the Trump administration is what happened in Puerto Rico.
Yeah.
Is it as bad as Katrina or worse?
I think in some respects it's worse. Although it's hard to, I don't know. I really don't know. I mean, I think they're in both instances, we're talking about a total disregard in terms of Puerto Rico. It seems almost like animosity. Mm-hmm. And on some level, you know, at least in the wake of Katrina, there seemed to be some type of national reckoning. And it seems to me in the wake of Puerto Rico, nobody cares in this country. So in that respect, I think what's going on in Puerto Rico is worse. But Puerto Ricans have been denied their rights in just about every way you could do it. It's good to see them get at least this small victory this week in getting the governor to resign, presuming that he does. I imagine he will. But I don't know. That's a tough call. It's a really tough call.
Now, Michael Brooks does your show. He's a self-avowed Marxist. We have Professor Ben Burgess, who you know, he comes on this show.
Yep.
Those two are further to the left than you are. Would you call yourself a liberal or a lefty, or is it fluid?
I would say that I'm a leftist. I've always sort of identified myself as of the left. I'm not so convinced that, you know, people say this to me, that Michael's to my left on things. I'm not quite convinced of that. I'm still trying to figure out in what areas. I mean, I think there's certainly stuff that I would nationalize.
For example, what would you nationalize?
Power, our oil refineries, cable, all of the pipes, as it were, of the internet, not the content, but I would, you know, the cable internet service. Yes, I would nationalize all of that. Anywhere where we have heavily regulated monopolies, I would nationalize. And, you know, mostly that's power, communications and whatnot. I obviously would do single payer healthcare system. I may not go as far to a nationalized, like a you know, an NHS type of thing. So maybe that's where the difference lies. But I just consider myself of the left. I don't get too worried about labeling myself. I think that that's one of the more unfortunate things that has come with this move to the left in the country. But if that's what it takes, great.
Has there been a political evolution? When did you start on Air America? What year?
2004.
That was a liberal, anti-Bush, almost an anti-war radio network. Were you against the invasion in 2003?
Yes. In fact, the first majority report I ever did was on Tom Sharpling's The Best Show on WFMU. He gave me 2 hours to come on his show in February of 2003. And I had a huge three-ring binder. John Benjamin, who does the voice of the existing majority report, came with me to New Jersey and did the live read to open it up. Janine Garofalo was a guest on that show. I also brought some poor soul from Fox and Friends on the weekend and just yelled at him for an hour or, you know, 20 minutes. He had no idea what was going on. Yeah, no, I was marching against the war and was very, very much against the war.
Okay, just so I can get a handle on your politics, 9/11, for or against?
I mean, look, everybody was everybody was, you know, wavering and trying to figure out what's the best way to position myself on this. Go ahead.
You have children.
I do.
Some of whom you're raising properly, some of whom I
split the difference. I have two. And so one, you know, I'm just experimenting. It's basically a way to experiment to see, like, what if I did it this way versus that way? And you know, that's why you have two.
It's called A-B testing, I believe.
Exactly.
Yeah. Are you afraid of the whole thing unraveling? When you talk to somebody who is a Bernie bro, you know, I'm a Bernie bro. My life has already, and I'm being serious, my life unraveled. You know, my kids are out of the house. I'm divorced. I got nothing to lose. Vote for Bernie. When you've got small kids, do you have a fear of the thing unraveling? Does it make you a little tentative? Is there a stutter step when you pull the lever for Bernie?
On the contrary, I think it is the impetus of my politics is my kids. And so I think I'm still worried about it all unraveling. Frankly, I don't know that Bernie is necessarily a bulwark against that. I don't know that anything is, but my support for Bernie and these policies is deeply rooted in my sense that I got to help my kids have a better future.
Do you fear the natural tendencies of the right? We see this in Spain before the rise of Franco. We saw it with the rise of Hitler. When the left, communists, when they are taking to the streets, the industrialists like to fan the flames. There are vigilantes and thugs who do extrajudicial beatings and killings. And there's chaos, which then normal people who might be sympathetic to the left see the chaos and they say, you know what, we need law and order. And we should have a temporary dictator. Can you see a well-animated left causing this country to move farther to the right? Kind of like what happened in 68 with Nixon.
Well, I'm not sure. I mean, I think there was other factors, right? There was a lot of it. And in some ways, I'm not convinced that what we saw with Donald Trump wasn't a very similar dynamic. But I'm not convinced it's really about the hippies or the leftists. I'm quite convinced it has more to do with race and gender. I don't think racists say to themselves, I'm a racist and I'm a misogynist and I'm a xenophobe, right? Like, I don't think they perceive it that way. I think there's just a sense of like, I am threatened by people who are not like me. And so I think when it came to, you know, the idea of Hillary Clinton after Barack Obama, I think there was a lot of people who were saying, and there's a lot of data to support this, that I don't want two non-normal presidents in a row. We gave them one, but I'm not doing two non-normal presidents in a row. That makes me feel like I'm really losing. And there's a great book. I don't know if you've spoken to any of the authors of it, but it's called Identity Crisis. And it's fascinating. This statistic from that interview, and I'm sure you heard the interview, but I'll remind you of it because I know you listened to every episode of The Majority Report. I think it was John Sides was one of the authors, I believe, if I'm not mistaken. And they found, and this is going to blow your, this is going to blow your mind, 50% of non-college educated white people in this country prior to the election of Barack Obama, in fact, prior to the presidency, I should say, thought the Republican Party was to the left of the Democrats when it came to race.
Is now, that because old habits die?
It's because it's you and I thought, although that got sorted out with Ronald Reagan.
Yeah. Right?
Like following the 65 Civil Rights Act and the Voting Rights Act, and it became clear the Democrats were going to side with all the non-whites in the country. Everybody started, you know, it created a shakeout, which became a realignment and landed, you know, in the 1980 election of Reagan. And by 84, after the 84 election, you know, they were talking about we have a realignment in this country. And all those Dixiecrats left the Democratic Party and became Republicans. Well, apparently, there was still a significant portion of those people who did not realize that the Democrats were more apt to, you know, to not discriminate against black people, I guess is the best way to put it. I think Barack Obama's presidency, despite the fact that he did his best to be, you know, as white a president as he could be, frankly, polarized things along race. And so I think you can even see it in terms of like the left liberals, their predisposition towards immigrants has changed dramatically too, for the better in my estimation, but it's a function of the same polarization. So I'm not convinced that it's necessarily like an ideological thing. I mean, yes, I think people, if there was sort of mass disruptions in the country from leftists, I think people would be like, hey, wait a second. This is getting a little bit carried away. I don't want, you know, black bloc tactics in my neighborhood. But that's not going to happen. What did happen was, and what is happening, is a change in the demographic makeup of this country. And white people who are worried about that. And I think it's not just like, they're not just worried about the sort of the browning, they're worried about all of it. They're worried about the browning and the feminizing, you know, in their minds, and the gayification that's taking place, and the Sharia law and the loss of their guns and all of this. And it's all one big mass in their mind, I think. And some of it's true. Like, you know, white guys are losing their cultural cachet.
Highest, you know, suicide rate, highest drug overdose rate is among white men.
Yes, that's true. Now, we should say that part of the reason why white people were more affected by opioids, the opioid epidemic, was because black people did not have as much health insurance.
Right.
And so they didn't have the same opportunity to get prescribed these drugs, these pharmaceutical drugs.
And the doctors were racist. They were less likely to
acknowledge pain. Right. And so but your point still stands. And I think that's true. I think there is it's hard to it used to be when we were kids with our parents. Our dad, you know, when we were kids growing up, we watched TV, and literally we were the center of the universe, right?
Mm-hmm.
It's like a little white kid who, and surrounded by things. Or as we got older, it's like, this is a show about a guy, you know, and particularly for guys like you and I, like Thursday night, when I went out to show business in 1993, Thursday night was Seinfeld, Paul Reiser, Schwimmer, Silverman. Mm-hmm. I mean, it, you know, go on and on and on. And all these white guys were at the center of, like, literally watch TV, every ad. It was always about the white guy, or maybe the doting wife who wants to make sure that her husband's shirts are clean. That's changed. And so I think there's a sense of loss. I think some of it is real. And how do you address that for a society? I think you can say, like, well, these are part of the growing pains of a society going forward. And I think that's true. Simultaneously, I think also, you know, it makes the things like stagnated wages over the past 40 years. It makes things like the inability of two people to work their ass off in a family and then still be able to, like, enjoy a nice vacation. It makes things like the cost of healthcare and housing going up that much more difficult to bear. And so I think we can't change the sort of the zero sum nature of what's changing in society as more people get emancipated. But I think we can help people in terms of material benefits.
So 2020, the mistake I think the Democrats made in 2016, and I may be making this in my rabid support for Bernie, I think Hillary and the Democrats wanted the election to be about this. And Trump said, no, it's about this. And the Democrats tried to frame it, and the American people liked Trump's framing, because he did win big. I mean, if you take California out of the picture, he won by a significant margin. And one of, you know, when you look at the Electoral College, that was one of the biggest wins for the Republicans, I believe, since 1988. He won big in the Electoral College. And if you take out California, he did pretty well with the popular vote. So,
well, yes. I mean, I guess if you eliminate randomly any 4 billion votes or so, but I mean, he got less votes than Mitt Romney. And look, there's a dozen reasons I could tick off right now why Hillary Clinton lost. Remind you, I think you recall that 16 years earlier, the election came down to 500 votes, right? I mean, so it's not like this was a shoo-in. We Barack Obama inspired a lot of people to vote who hadn't voted in the past, and was a uniquely charismatic candidate in a time where the country was really also ready to get rid of of the Republicans. Yeah. I'm quite convinced that Martin O'Malley would have beaten Donald Trump. I mean, I'm O'Malley would have won guy. I also happen to think that just about anybody, I'm not sure if Lincoln Chafee could have beat him, but I'm not convinced he couldn't. I think Hillary Clinton was uniquely ill-suited for that particular election. I think her strategy sucked. I think her tactics sucked. I think she also had a tremendous amount of, like, baggage that went into it, which was silly for people to ignore. They presumed that it's only going to make her stronger. But in fact, like, turns out it's a bad thing to have a candidate who has a cottage industry, not any function of what she did, but literally there is an industry of people who have made full careers just attacking Clinton. Like, literally, mm-hmm. Like, we had nothing. There's nothing. Nothing can exist like that again. You know, you'll have Oppo research people, but not people who are like, I as a young kid, I did the exact same thing I did as a 50-year-old man. And that is, I made hundreds of thousands of dollars a year creating fictions about the Clintons. On top of it, I think she just ran there just a myriad of different things. Never mind, like, the Benghazi hearings, the 7 Benghazi hearings, which brought you the emails, Comey there. And still she lost by 70,000 votes in across 3 states.
Right.
And, I'm not convinced that, you know, had she visited those states, that wouldn't have made a difference. Maybe it would have, maybe wouldn't have, but, you know, there's a myriad of different things.
Well, in my limited time left with you, let's turn to the Mueller report. And do you think Cambridge Analytica and the Russians were able to program Facebook ads to change our minds? Do you think Facebook is that potent a weapon in politics that it can swing an election in these swing states?
Well, all right, look, I don't know. I mean, my first inclination is to doubt it, but we're living in such an era that I just don't think we understand what happened. Does what you and I do matter?
Yes.
I mean, does it though? I don't know. I really don't know. But if what you and I do matters, okay, then certainly let's just say, I don't know, someone like Jimmy Dore, what he does matters.
Do you know that he read a book?
I understand that.
Yeah, he read a book. Go ahead.
I think it's Clinton Cash.
Go ahead.
But more to the point, Jimmy Dore did a couple of videos, promoted the idea that Hillary Clinton had Parkinson's. Now, we know that this was amped up and inflated by, you know, what the GRU people, the social media, the Russians did on social media. Is Jimmy Dore convinced by one of those bots or whatever that Hillary Clinton has Parkinson's? And so he goes out and does multiple videos of this, claiming that she has Parkinson's when she, you know, had the flu one time and tripped or something, and gets 150,000, 200,000 views on this thing. Maybe it's more. Maybe it was a couple hundred thousand views. And I don't know, 1,000 people who watch that video go out and they tell 5 people. I mean, that's 5,000 people. I mean, like, I don't know. I really don't know if what they did influenced things. Like I say, in an election this close, who knows? Mm-hmm. And so, like, I you know, because I don't know if I believe what you and I do means anything either. It may or may not. And so I don't know.
Were you disgusted by Mueller? I was disgusted by Mueller.
Look,
him personally. I was disgusted by him personally.
Like his physicalness or, I mean, like, listen, Mueller is a guy who, aside from, you know, maybe carrying some water in the Iraq war, I mean, he was, I don't know how much influence he had when he got up there, but he was the FBI agent. He was probably relying on, like, you know, other intel agencies. But the stuff that he did in the wake of 9/11 was pretty heinous in my estimation, in terms of, like, basically, you know, rounding up anybody and entrapping, I think, a lot of Muslim people. And this, I'm not a huge fan of Republicans, period.
Letting the bin Ladens fly home?
Sure. I mean, all of it. All of
it.
I would have appointed Larry Krasner as a special prosecutor, but I wasn't in a position to do that, right? From Philadelphia. But I thought the testimony he gave, I mean, I think he's frankly, he's a little bit cowardly. You take that job, you should do the job.
Mm-hmm.
And he sat there and basically was like, I can't say the word impeachment, but if you say the word impeachment and ask me to cough twice, to mean impeachment. I mean, that's what he literally did at one point, right? He said, like, there are other constitutional processes. What are those processes? I'd rather not say. Well, are you referring to one of those processes as impeachment? It's the thing you just said. Like, yeah, he said that.
Mm-hmm.
And he went on there and he said, you know, the idea that he wouldn't subpoena the president. Well, if you don't subpoena, and when he was asked this by Maloney, why didn't you subpoena the president? He said, because we felt time pressure and it would have taken at least a year. Well, first off, if it would have taken a year, that would have been on Donald Trump for not testifying.
Exactly.
But secondly, the other part that he said that is really crucial that I don't think is getting enough attention is they weigh the value of talking to that witness, potential subject, actually, of the investigation, Donald Trump. And he said this was hugely important in other places in the report. They weigh that against the existing amount of evidence they have. And if the existing amount of evidence they have crosses a threshold where they could prove this, prove the charges, then they don't pursue that subpoena.
But he would, but he wouldn't even give them that. He would say that.
He said what I just said, he said to Maloney.
But then walked it back by implying that we were.
He just said, I'm not making a determination. So he's lying. He's playing a double game because he's afraid. And I'm sorry, that level of cowardliness, don't take the job. Don't take the job. You saw what Bill Barr did. You got up there and you did this two-step. People rely on a prosecutor to tell them if there is a preponderance of evidence to go forward with a conviction. Just because the DOJ says we can't indict, if you're aware and you're writing in your report that there is an other constitutional procedure for this prosecution, well, you're the lead prosecutor. You hand it over to Congress. He didn't hand it over to Congress. He sort of just fumbles with it, right? He fumbles with it. He sort of like tosses it up in the air and just sort of gives like a knowing wink and says, stick your hand in, stick your hand in, grab it.
Maybe Mueller did do his job. Maybe he did do the job that he was hired to do.
I don't know. I think he feels like on some level, he, like James Comey, these guys could not have a higher estimation of themselves.
Right.
And they think that they
have to keep a lid on it.
Just a question to keep a lid on it. James Comey, I had a buddy who was a U.S. attorney who said that he sat in an auditorium when he first got in and they swore everybody in. And James Comey was just laid it on. You never, ever, ever, ever interfere in an election, this and that. And Comey took it upon himself to do it because he felt he knew why he was doing it. Look, I have a whole theory about what was going on with the FBI and Felix Sater and there being a Whitey Bulger thing. It's all half-baked. But there's no doubt in my mind there is a ton of stuff that we will never know about what actually went on.
Right.
And there's no
Sater is kind of pitching the Whitey Bulger narrative openly. He's saying he was a double agent.
Well, it's not just him. It's not just him. Loretta Lynch filed an affidavit on his behalf back in the day when he stabbed the guy in the face with a champagne flute. Now, I don't know why the U.S. attorney for the Eastern District of New York would just do that for no reason. The guy was an asset. There's no doubt about it. He was an FBI and a CIA asset, and he would trace money laundering money. That's all been publicly reported.
Right.
And like I say, there's an affidavit signed by Loretta Lynch in some court docket somewhere, which is indicative of it. And the only reason why I focus on Felix Sater is because the late Wayne Barrett, before he passed away, had done more reporting on Donald Trump than any living human being. And he said, it's all about Sater. And Sater was also involved in BlackRock and, a special advisor to Donald Trump. I mean, if this guy was running, it was money laundering and feeding the CIA and FBI information that you would pick up if you're in the business of money laundering, like Bin Laden's cell phone number and where this money is going and who's buying arms for this and who's, he needs a place to launder the money too, right?
Right.
And I have a feeling that was Donald Trump's properties. Certainly that's what it sounds like the Russian tower was about. And I don't know if Donald Trump was aware of any of this. My guess would be, why would you ever tell that idiot anything? But if Felix Sater was this asset, he would have been run out of the New York FBI office. And if you go back to the reporting in September and October, there was like reports of like a mutiny going on there. And presumably it was because they were aware that Comey was investigating Donald Trump. You know, everything I'm saying is all publicly available information.
Right.
I don't know what that means, but I'm very familiar with the Whitey Bulger case because that was out of Massachusetts. And there you had some FBI guys who were letting Whitey Bulger do some stuff. And then it just came back to bite him in the ass. I'm not convinced that we don't have a similar situation here.
Yeah. You're saying Sater was helping the FBI find Bin Laden. He had his phone number. And I'm going to let you go. But the takeaway from this is like the Kennedy assassination, like Contragate, Russiagate, you don't want to go there. You're staring into the abyss of American history.
Right.
Look away.
I think the idea was that he offered up like obstruction, right? It's sort of a second order thing. It means that people don't investigate the sort of like, we didn't hear much about the main question about Donald Trump or any of that stuff. It was all sort of second order stuff. And that's fine. You know, it's like, yeah, let's not get him for the bloodstains in the trunk of the car. We can lock him up for speeding, you know, going 75 in a 25-mile-an-hour zone. I think there could be a little of that. Look, obviously, my feeling is this. You do oversight and you investigate and you impeach, because if you don't, the Republicans are going to fill that vacuum. And you make the Republican Party own Donald Trump even more. That's why you do this. It's a political process. You do it for political reasons. You certainly have the moral and I think like civic reasons to impeach Donald Trump, too.
Mm-hmm. You've given me some clarity about Mueller. He's the guy you bring in to keep a lid on everything. He was the head of the FBI right after 9/11, and he kept a lid on that. We really don't know who was behind 9/11. And it's complicated. And when you're part of the ruling class, the ruling elite, and I'm not passing judgment, you think that if all this gets exposed, it's not good for the country. We infantilize the American people. If they only knew, there'd be blood in the streets.
I definitely think there is a sense of like, you know, when these guys think that they are, you know, serving their country, they don't see people.
Yeah.
They see like some type of like the realm of some sort. And they think that they're doing a duty and you know, they don't have a duty. They don't have to abide by the sort of the laws that are set down to sort of like for daily operations, essentially. Mm-hmm.
Well, you have kids, and you keep certain things from them. They're not ready.
That's right. That's absolutely right. And I have no doubt that they make a similar calculation.
They treat us like children, and it makes us feel powerless. Well, Sam Seder.
And, you know, I look around. Some of us are like children.
Yes.
David.
Hmm?
David.
You can't see what I did in my pants right now.
I can smell it.
Then you dealt it. Sam Seder.
what a suspicious way to end that.
Yeah, fantastic. Sam Seder is the host of the Majority Report Monday through Friday. You got to watch him. You're fantastic. Thank you, sir. Can you stay on the line for 1 second?
Sure.
Thank you.